Today we'll be talking about surgery for ankylosing spondylitis, and I think these are the nightmare for spine surgeons who have to operate on these patients. Obviously, very rarely we go electively. Most of the time it's an emergency that we have to go in, and in different centers they usually call the spines from hell. So it's an old disease and was first defined in 1694 by a French graveyard worker who described it as if a layer of material has been poured all over the skeleton and then it has solidified. In 1884, Stumpel defined two clinical cases of ankylosing spondylitis, and 1892, Bastrieu defined meningeal and spinal cord involvement, and which later on came to know as Bastrieu's disease. In 1898, Mary described the entity as separate from all other types of arthritis which involved the spine. So as the history progressed, in 1920s, x-rays were invented and the findings of sacroiliitis and syndesmophytes were seen. 1930s to 15s, there were different discoveries in Egypt and also in Viking ships which showed skeletons which had ankylosing spondylitis. In 50s, the discovery of human leukocyte antigen progressed our knowledge in this aspect, and in 1960s, American Rheumatism Association recognized spondylopathies as a distinct group of inflammatory arthritis. In 73, association found the link between the HLA-B27 and the spondyloarthropathies, but the link is not that clear. All the patients with ankylosing, almost 95% have HLA positive, but all the HLA positive patients do not go on to develop ankylosing spondylitis. That's a very important thing to remember. And again, the different manifestations have different rate of positivity of HLA-B27. It is a combination of different inflammatory and pathologic processes that's going on in the spine, with subchondral tissue becoming granulomatous and infiltrated by inflammatory cells. Then there are bone reactive sclerosis and resorption and erosions. Then there's bone remodeling, which converts into fibrocartilage is replaced, and the normal tissue and new bone formation and ankylosis is seen. Epidemiology is also a bit interesting. Males, as usual, are affected 3 times more than females, and the disease is more severe in males than in females, and they have more axial symptoms. It may be due to their hard-working jobs or something, but most commonly, I think it's disease itself that manifests more in male. Even siblings and twins suggest 16 to 50% incidence, and the average age is 15 to 40, but a German study kept a mean at 28. So the patient presenting with back pain, almost 5% would have ankylosing spondylitis or some signs and symptoms of it. And we need to follow these patients, because even if they do not go into full-fledged ankylosing spine, if we treat them as if they had ankylosing spondylitis, they're clinically better off. So making the diagnosis is important, because simple back pain between these patients and the patients with mechanical pain is different. Usually the inflammatory pains are prolonged and not associated with activity. They are more early in the morning than as compared to mechanical back pains, which are more when the patient is tired and has worked out. The activity improves inflammatory back pains while it aggravates the symptoms in mechanical back pains, and the usual onset is early in inflammatory back pains, while it's usually an older, middle and older age group that suffers the mechanical back pains. And the usual radiograph findings in inflammatory back pains are sacroiliitis, vertebral ankylosing spondylitis, while in degenerative we have osteophytes, spondylolisthesis, and scoliosis. A simple clinical test that we can do is a Schober test, in which a mark is put on the back and the patient is made to flex. If the distance increased by more than 5 centimeters, then they have a good spine. If it is restricted, then the distance is usually less than 5 centimeters, and show that it's a restricted and kyphotic spine. Another test that you can do is a wall to tragus distance, in which the patient is put against the wall and the distance is measured. Usually it has to be more than 10 centimeters. If it's increasing, that means the patient has increased kyphosis. Same is occipital wall test. The principle remains the same: as the kyphosis increases, the distance between the wall and the occiput increases. So the common radiographic findings that you will find on the x-rays are ankylosis or a bamboo spine that is more commonly used, a shiny vertebral corals or remnant signs with squaring of the vertebral bodies. You can see sacroiliitis, syndesmophyte formation, and Anderson lesions. So there, most commonly see sacroiliitis, then remnant signs, squaring of the body, then syndesmophytes, and then ankylosis. So here you can see the sacroiliitis that you will see on the x-rays, and here's sacroiliitis on the CT scan, which has progressed in both pictures. Here's remnant signs, which you can see squaring of the bodies and also the edges that are very shiny. Here, syndesmophytes and the Anderson disease. Anderson disease usually looks like an instability or a kind of discitis. But this one entity we know will progress, and all the clinical and biological agents do not tend to control the progress of the disease. If you see this thing, then surgery is the only option. No medical treatment is possible in these lesions. So the common complications from AS that we've seen are spinal stiffness, ankylosis. The rate of infections or fractures is also increased because the spine becomes like a single long moment arm. It's like a single long rod which does not bend, so it breaks very easily. Then these patients are usually on painkillers and biological agents. They have more infections. And also we can have sterile cordaquina and arachnoiditis that can result in cordaquina syndrome. So the progression usually follows when the patient starts developing this disease, their spines become kyphotic. And as the kyphosis increases, they try to compensate it with their pelvic tilt. They try to retrovert their pelvis. And once that mechanism fails, they start bending their knees. So this also affects their hip and back and sacroiliitis joint and also their knees. And once both these mechanisms fail, then this kyphosis becomes so much increased that they just cannot see anything rather than the floor. They cannot see what's in front, and they have very difficult and miserable life. So usually surgery is for progressive ossification of the annulus fibrosis and other spinal ligaments that ultimately lead to a rigid and kyphotic spine. Spine surgery is sometimes indicated and most frequently to treat fractures and to correct the deformities that are present. Particularly prone to a number of potentially catastrophic complications because of the long moment arms, these fractures tend to dislocate more than any normal fractures, and they are more unstable than any other normal fractures. And if there's presence of Anderson lesions, you have to go for surgery. So main indications are severe, unremitting back and neck pain that has not responded to non-surgical treatment. There is nerve damage caused by spinal deformity, trauma, or there is progressive neurological weakness due to stenosis that has developed at different levels. And you have an unstable spine after trauma. And if there's a decreased ability to hold the head up and see horizontally, and if there's difficulty completing everyday activities like eating and drinking because of spinal deformity. So you can see the pre and post-op images of a patient who was severely kyphosed preoperatively, and then post-operatively we can make them see upright and make their life a lot better. The major risks in these patients are, first of all, is delayed diagnosis. These patients have chronic pain. They are chronic users of painkillers. So small fractures and other things can be easily missed. Then they have very, very osteoporotic and unstable spines. Even simple x-rays most of the time miss the simple fractures that these patients get from very trivial falls. So if you have a patient with ankylosing spondylitis with a trauma, always go for a CT scan and MRI if you don't want to miss any injuries. Then the rehab of these patients, even after surgery, is also very difficult because they have decreased lung capacities. They have different restricted range of motions, of movements, and other things. So physiotherapy and other rehab and mobilization is a big challenge, even before and after surgery. And they are very poor conservative response because the fractures that develop are usually aorospine grade A, B, C, D, or more. They're complex ones, and these fractures tend to cross vertebra. Usually 2 to 3 vertebra often get involved, and they usually have progressive deficit. So in these cases, we know these angst spots, they also don't fuse. So conservative treatment is very poor in these patients. So you will have to go for surgery if you have a patient with trauma. And the neurological deficits is more. They easily bore fractured bones due to osteoporosis, and they fracture like chalk sticks. They do not usually fracture at the disc points in normal trauma that we see. And also the reduction, mobilization, and positioning is also very different in these patients. Then the anesthesia becomes problematic because of poor chest capacities. These are fused bones, fused joints, and these are very vascular bones. So they also tend to bleed a lot during operation. And also we need to do larger than required operations in these patients because there's no movement at the joints that you can use. And then because of the increased deformity from stabilizing the patient to putting the patient for anesthesia to post-op care, their deformity creates problem at every step. So for anesthetic complications, obviously their spine is scaphotic, their necks are also fused.
Dr. Kosin, please wind up.
Sure, I'll try to be as quick as possible. So in these cases, you would need a nasal intubation and an assisted intubation. They have ankylosed jaw, so there's no mouth opening, and there is restricted disease in the lung capacities, and they're usually on immunosuppressants. Ideally, you have to stop these immunosuppressants or their disease-modifying agents that they're taking at least 2.5 weeks. Or if they're long-acting agents, you should try to stop them at least 2.5 times the drug's lifespan. So positioning, you have to achieve reduction. The blood loss is a problem. You need to do long segment fixations. Usually the formula is 1 above, or if you do ideally 2 above and 2 below, but in these patients, you have to do at least 3 above and 3 below to stabilize these spines. And there are various types of osteotomies, SPOs, Smith-Peterson, pedicle subtraction osteotomies, or vertebral resection that you need to do. If I had time, we can go into the techniques, but I think because of the lack of time, we'll just stay with the principles. So you can do percutaneous screws and minimally invasive to reduce the blood loss and complications. Simple paradigm that you can follow for these disease. First, you need to have an experience in a center where these complex surgeries can be done. If you do not have a good medically fit patient or experience, then you should just stick with simple facetectomies or just don't do anything at all, fix them in situ. If you have a good patient and a good experience, then you have to decide if it's a sharp curve or a gradual curve. If it's a gradual curve, and you can just go for multi-level facetectomies or SPOs, but if there's a sharp wedging or there's acute angle that needs to be corrected, you can go for vertebral column resections and PSOs. So for surgical planning, just determine the amount of correction needed and the flexibility of the curve if there is any. You can see it on prone and flexion extension films and CT and MRI. Surgical factors is most important is experience. Second is location, where you're working, what kind of help and services you have available, and the setting, what kind of setup you're working in, and does it have all the equipment and services that are required and needed. So for example, this spine, you would need to first identify which levels need treatment and then do all your biomedical and biomechanical measurements and find out how much correction do you want. So in this case, you need at least 91 degrees of correction. So for this correction, you have different approaches, anterior, posterior, and lateral. Anteriorly, you can do facetectomy, ponti osteotomy, vertebral column resection, anterior discectomy, or interbody releases, while in lateral, you can do discectomy and ALL releases. Depending upon the amount of correction, SPOs usually give you about 9 to 10 degrees of correction per level.
Please.
Just winding up. So if you're doing simple facetectomy or SPOs, you can just do multiple 5 levels of these things. And if you want to have at least 25 to 30 degrees, you can have pedicle subtraction osteotomies. And if you want more major corrections, more than 40, 45 degrees, then you can go for vertebral column resections at dorsal and lumbar level. They are both possible. I think this is all I had time for. We can go into the techniques, but I think due to lack of time, we have to pack up. I think Dr. Thaira will talk about the clinical things next. So thank you very much. And if you have any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Mohsin.